Kenny is in Raleigh, North Carolina. Hi, Kenny. Welcome to the Dave Ramsey Show.
Hey, Dave. Glad to be here.
Thank you for joining us. So you have a net worth of over $1 million. What's your net worth, sir?
Oh, I guess it's probably around $20
million. Pretty cool. That's sweet.
Yeah.
And how in the world did you do that?
Oh, I was very lucky and inherited everything, Dave. No, that's not exactly how it happened.
You just blew my whole setup. What's wrong with you, Kenny?
Right. Well, I fell off the back of a turnip truck here in North Carolina and, you know, and just got paid on it is what it was. No, it was a lot of things, but there was really just one key moment, probably as much as anything. I started my company, it's a restaurant chain. I started it 24 years ago.
Which restaurant chain?
What's that?
What restaurant chain is it?
It's called Highway 55.
Oh, yeah. Well, no wonder you're worth $20 million. Yeah, that's awesome, man. So no wonder you're worth $20 million. How many stores have y'all got?
There's 115 now. We're in 8 states, soon to be 10, and 2 foreign countries. Just opened up in Denmark. So.
And you started with nothing?
Started with literally nothing. I'd fired from a job, $500 in my pocket, and an 18-month-old son at home. And had just purchased our first home. So we were land barons for the first time, too, and here I was unemployed.
Land barons.
Yeah. Well, that's what we like to call it anyway. You know, we're pretty proud
of
ourselves.
So how many years before you got to 5 stores?
Well, I actually got to 5 in year 2. I'll tell you how I did it. It was a lot of in-house financing, finding closed restaurants, remodeling them with my own scrubbing equipment and getting on my knees and doing a little construction and remodeling closed stores is kind of how I got going.
Gotcha.
Going to auction sales and
so
buying
most
equipment.
Of your net worth is in the restaurant chain, I assume.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm a franchisor, so we have franchisees out there.
Okay. But you didn't inherit anything.
No.
Your average income through those years must have been pretty spectacular.
Not in the early years. You know, in the early years, one time, as a matter of fact, the first year I was in business, I remember adding it up. I worked open to close every day, 10 in the morning till 10 at night, and cooked the food and everything. And I think we figured it out one time, it was about $2.60 an hour, $2.60 an hour the first year I was in business. Yeah. And I tell you, but here was the scary part. If you had talked to me back then and you'd have said, hey, how's business? You'd have gotten a 45-minute dissertation because I was passionate about my $2.60 an hour job and what we were trying to accomplish. Yep.
You already could see the future.
You know, I could see 20, believe it or not. In the very early days, I could see 20. Even at the end of year one, when I was $35,000 behind on my food bills, I could still see 20. I really could. And I didn't quite know how I was going to get there. I didn't physically know if I'd be able to make it because I was doing everything back then. But I could definitely see 20.
Did you graduate from college?
Yes, thank goodness for athletics, because I graduated high school. I was middle of the road. As a matter of fact, North Carolina State recruited me and couldn't get in. I didn't have the grades to get in. So thank goodness I was a pretty good baseball player, and I was able to go to Mount Olive, North Carolina, and play at the junior college for the first 2 years. So
what was your GPA in college?
Now, I did wake up in college. I grew up a little bit, and I ended up with about a 2.5 cumulative. So. Yeah. Why do you laugh at that? I think that's
a GPA
good,
point per 10 million. Yeah. I like it. Hey, I want to ask you a couple more questions. Can you hang with me through the break?
Absolutely.
All right. Wow. The owner of Highway 55 Restaurants, $20 million net worth. Our first call in on our Millionaire Theme Hour. Kenny's with us. We're going to get a little bit more info when we come back from the break. It's a Millionaire Theme Hour. We're talking with Kenny in Raleigh, North Carolina, one of our millionaire callers, to learn about how to become a millionaire. He started a restaurant some 20, 30 years ago called Highway 55. Now he's got stores all over America, net worth of $20 million, and had an average GPA in college of 2.5. That's another piece we established. Didn't inherit anything. Started out broke doing it that way. Is that a fair summary of what you told me so far, Kenny?
It doesn't sound very impressive, but that's pretty fair, yeah.
Well, it's a lot of hard work in between those years. How many years ago did you start?
It was 24 years ago.
And what would you say your average personal income is over all those years?
Over all those years, probably $200,000.
Okay.
Yeah, I've always purposely kept that down. As a matter of fact, a few years ago when the economy got tough, I remember my CFO walked in and said, look, everybody in here needs to take a 10% pay cut. And I said, nah, I can't do that. And I took a 50. Mm-hmm. I'm not telling you that so you clap me on the back. I'm just telling you that sometimes you hear people out there, they act like CEOs and we're all just, you know, beasts, and we take and run our people around and, mm-hmm. and throw them crumbs, and it's just not the case. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, about 200,000, maybe 250.
How old are you now?
I'm 52.
Okay. And how many new cars have you bought in your life?
I just got one, and it's paid for. Mm-hmm. You'll be happy to know, mm-hmm. and the listeners. But that's my thing. You know, it's not clothes. It's not anything fancy, jewelry, anything like that. It's an automobile. When I was growing up in a lower middle class, is what we like to call it, family, you know, seeing a cool car
yep.
was kind of my thing. You
yep.
know, and
yep.
and so actually, I just got one. I traded a Tesla Model S
yeah.
For a Maserati, and yeah. and basically did a straight up trade, and they're paid for.
Sweet car. So how many yeah. new cars have you bought in your life? So if you're a car
probably,
guy.
Probably 10.
Okay. All right. That's yeah. cool. Well, you can afford it. You can afford it. No question.
Yeah.
Talk to me about giving. What role has that played?
No, it's huge. It's what the whole company's founded upon. And if you got a second, I'll kind of explain that. It was 1991 that I started the company. In 92, I was $35,000 behind on my food bills. And I was riding home one night, and I just remember having this internal conversation, you know, just running through my head. You know, you often hear people say, just be passionate and work hard, and you'll be successful. Well, I couldn't have been any more passionate. I couldn't have worked any harder, and here I was, $35,000 behind on my food bills. So I'm having this conversation, and I wish I could tell you the sky opened up or something dramatic like that happened, and it wasn't that way, but just as clear as I'm talking to you right now, a voice in my head said, it's not about you. And so, I mean, I kept me up about half the night, and I got up the next morning, and I changed the direction of the company. I made it about serving everybody else in the company, and within 6 months, we were in the black. And what I mean by serving them is we have literally made over 50 minimum wage employees owners of their own restaurants through the years, where we in-house finance them. They have literally started out of the minimum wage, worked into management, and then into ownership. And as a matter of fact, July 1, I'm selling two more to two young men that are very deserving. And, you know, so by turning the way I thought and making it about meeting their needs before my own even got met, that was the real breaking point. That was where the company changed. And and as we look for franchisees now, we're looking for people with that same character and that same integrity.
By the way, that's more fun than all the other stuff we're talking about, isn't it?
It's awesome. I'll tell you, the first time that I was ever able to, you know, there's a lot of people out there that'll dangle that carrot,
mm-hmm.
say, hey, come get it, you know, and people burn out. Well, mm-hmm. When I said, hey, when I tell you can be an owner, and the first time I ever made somebody an owner, and I stood them up in front of the rest of the managers, and I said, look, this person's earned it, they've worked hard, they've done this and that, that was one of the proudest days of my life.
Yeah.
That was, you know, that mm-hmm. and my children being born were about hand in hand. It was mm-hmm. really special, and every time we do it, it's just as special. So, but giving, yes, very big on it. We have a foundation, mm-hmm. Golf tournament. We raise money. We teach our 16 and 17-year-olds that mm-hmm. it's not about them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they actually bake cookies for our foundation. We raise money mm-hmm. about 3 months out of the year. We raise over $100,000, about $125,000, and we give it away to kids' causes. So we're teaching them amazing lessons at the same time, more than just working in a hamburger place for minimum wage.
I hear you. Very cool, Kenny. Thank you so much. Wow. What an incredible story. Thank you so much. Thanks for joining us. Hey, next time you're in Nashville, swing by. I'd love to meet you in person. In the lobby, just joining us, hanging out, Dan is with us, who just stopped by to have a cookie today and get a picture made and so forth at the commercial break, and said, hey, he would jump on. Hey, Dan, how are you?
Good, sir. How are you?
Better than I deserve. Where do you live?
South of Washington, D.C., Southern Maryland.
Okay, cool. So you wanted to join the conversation because you've done this too.
Yeah, I happen to be walking in and heard the topic. It's like, wow, I knew answers to some of the questions.
So how much is your nest egg?
My wife and I were a little over $2 million, or right at that amount.
Okay, excellent. And how old are you?
51.
Just 51. Okay, so you've been working, what, 25 years?
About
27 years. All right, cool. And your income now, household income?
It's a little over 200.
Okay, and what was your average through that 27 years, would you say?
I would say our average household was 90,000.
Okay. All right. So you didn't average over 100. And what do you do for a living? What do y'all do for a living, both of you?
I'm a systems engineer. And my wife's a financial analyst.
Okay. Very cool. Very cool. And so did you, what is the money in, is that your 401ks and mutual funds or what? What's it in?
It's $1.2 million in all retirement pretty much, mostly mutual funds, a little bit of stocks. I would say it's conservative as well, relatively conservative, not full bore stocks. The rest is real estate. We have a home rental property, and also we bought a condominium at the beach about 5 years ago, and started listening to you about 5 years ago, and a lot of that was leveraged or debt, and just recently paid off a couple of weeks ago. I would have tried to do the debt-free scream piece, but my wife said, you're not doing that without me, and unfortunately, she couldn't be here today.
Okay, well, we'll schedule that later for you. We'll get you back on. That's fun. So you're debt-free, of course. I haven't asked the other people that. I should have done that, but they all are. Okay. James said that we did check with them. All right. And so this is 401k money and rental real estate, basically, and your home. And so you have a good match at your companies over the years?
Not spectacularly. 3 to 5% in there.
Okay. Did you have any one big hit, or did you inherit money, or did you start with wealth?
No, I didn't start with wealth, but you know, I grew up in Maryland, went to University of Maryland. My parents did pay. I lived at home, but my parents did pay for tuition then, which when I started in 1982, it was like about $700 a semester. And so I did have, they had no college debt or anything like that. So took advantage of being in state. I guess I've always thought financially, and the compound interesting, the interest piece, caught my eye and all that kind of thing. So.
It does inspire you the first time you understand. I put Ben and Arthur in my first book, and I've tried to use that chart ever since when we're teaching about this, because it just shows you the power of saving money. And when you start talking about saving $100 a month, you know, that turns into $1 million, you know, and, you know, for that number of years. And really, that's right where you are. You're a little, obviously double that. But so you don't attribute this to any one big thing. I mean, you didn't like strike it rich at the poker table or have one stock that went through the roof or something like that.
No.
There was no get rich quick in this. You didn't hit the lottery.
Not at all. It was all live below my means. Some of my family, I'm sure, thinks I've been cheap through the years. But the only new car I bought was right out of college. Got kind of signed up. It's like that's the thing you do. But we bought one other new one, but that was with cash. Everything else has been with cash. Never had a car loan or anything. It's kind of nice to go in there and not have to worry about that.
So no student loans, no car loans the whole time?
No.
Okay. So staying out of debt enabled you to do this. You guys take vacations?
Modest vacations. We're looking to take more now.
Well, you got a beach house. So
Yeah. We go there a few times a year for sure. Okay.
Very cool. So you're listening. I'll say the same thing to you I said to the other guys. There's a 24-year-old version of you out there listening right now. What do you tell them? How did you become worth $2 million?
Don't try to keep up with the Joneses. Live below your means. Always be forward-looking. Apply yourself at whatever your career goal is. And as I've gotten older, and I wish I'd known younger, you know, really work with your spouse and be a team. That helps a great deal.
Very cool. Dan, thanks for jumping on the mic. Hey, Alan, tell me your story. What's your net worth?
Hi, Dave. It's great to speak with you. Thanks so much for what you do.
Thank you.
My net worth, I guess I'm a piker compared to those last two. I'm just at $1.2 million now. I'm 60 years old.
Okay. And what is this, what's it invested in?
Well, I've got 800,000 in retirement accounts, roughly 200,000 in liquid assets, and then the balance of it is in my house, cars, et cetera. There's no debt.
All right. Very cool. Very cool. And what was your average income through your working lifetime, sir?
It varied greatly. During most of that time, I was 100% commission salesman. And so if I had to average it out, it'd probably be between 80 and 90.
Okay. Did you guys inherit money?
No.
No money inherited?
Okay. None.
All right. So what do you attribute the fact that you're a millionaire in America, where people say that can't be done now?
Well, it was pretty simple for us, really. We just never changed our lifestyle to any great degree. Because I was 100% commissioned, you never knew. You know, you're only as good as your last sale. So you always try to keep a good rainy day fund. Well, the rainy day fund just kept growing and growing and growing. the rainy day, fortunately, because God has been very, very good to us, and we give him the glory. The rainy days have been few and far between, so we just been able to put the money away.
Very cool. How much debt do you have now, and how much debt have you been in through the years?
Zero. I have no debt now. We paid our house off over 10 years ago. And I could never tolerate debt. Even before it was cool, I just couldn't take debt. I couldn't reconcile in my mind increasing my lifestyle through debt. It just bothered me to the point where now I don't care.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Everything's paid for, and that's the way I like it.
How many new cars have you all bought in your life?
Well, we keep our cars for 10 years, so we generally will buy a new one. We bought two cars and a truck.
Okay.
And trucks for work. It's 2008. It's got 130,000 miles on it. It's still running like the day I bought it. So mm-hmm. We'll keep it for quite a while.
What part in your financial plan does generosity play?
Well, we tithe, of course, and we've gotten to the point now where we can help out our family members when they need it, and it's such a blessing to be able to do that, to be a resource for people when they truly need it. My mom, I have issues with my mother. She's in poor health, and I'm able to help out, and it never is a burden for us. So we praise God that we're able to do that.
What's the most ridiculous expensive thing you all have bought?
Most ridiculous expensive thing? I guess it'd have to be one of the cars. I mean, we bought a top-end car, and we probably could have saved a little money by buying a lower model, but it was just a Honda Accord. And
your top-end car?
Yeah, we never spent a lot of money. We just my wife is very frugal, and I have to give her a lot of the credit because she'll come home. We've been married for 37 years. She'll come home proudly from the grocery store every time and tell me how much she saved with coupons. She's a coupon clipper from way back, and she never pays full price for anything. So,
what'd you pay for your last pair of blue jeans?
Well, it was in high school, so.
You don't wear blue jeans at all?
Yeah, I wear blue jeans, but my wife.
What'd your wife pay for your last pair of blue jeans?
Probably $10.
The ones you're wearing like today?
Well, I got on khakis today. The ones I got on today, probably $20.
Okay. All right. What is your recommendation to a 25-year-old listening to you right now?
Don't change your standard of living when you get a raise. Put the money away. Don't bite on the commercials and say you need this, you need that to be happy, because it's just not true.
What do you say to people that say, I need to live today, to heck with tomorrow. I don't want to be 60 years old before I'm enjoying this.
Well, tomorrow will get here, and when it does, it's going to hurt. So you got to be satisfied with the small things. It's like God tells us in Hebrews 13:5, keep yourself free from the love of money and be satisfied with what you have.
Mm. Very cool. Yeah, contentment is a key thing in people that build wealth. I've noticed that over the years, and it shows up often in these hours. Alan, you're a great American success story, you and your wife. God has blessed you, sir, and he's blessed the diligence that you put into this, and I appreciate you sharing your story. Rachel's with us in Denver. Rachel, welcome to A Millionaire Theme Hour. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Dave. Glad to be on.
What is your net worth?
Just actually a little bit over $3 million now.
Awesome. Very cool. And what's that invested in?
It's invested in real estate, in 401ks, IRAs, annuities, hedge funds.
How much of it's in your 401ks?
I'd say probably about a good 10%.
About 10%?
Yeah.
About $300,000. So where's most of the $3
million? Real estate. We've got actually quite a bit in cash. IRAs, mm-hmm. and pretty much so.
How much did you inherit?
Zero.
And how old are you guys?
I'm just turned 57, and my husband just turned 66.
Okay. So throughout your working lifetime, what was your average household income?
About $95,000 to $150,000 a year, but mm-hmm. right now we actually are earning $275,000 a year. With four income sources, things we're doing.
Yeah, you should if you have $3 million in assets. Yeah, that's cool.
That's right.
Okay, and what career field were you guys in?
Well, I started off in marketing, but now I'm an IT program manager, and my husband has been in sales the whole time.
It's marketing and sales and IT, okay. Mm-hmm. And what's your degree in?
My degree is actually in marketing.
What about his?
In liberal arts, English.
Gotcha. And what was your GPA?
Mine was actually, I worked full-time and mm-hmm. went to school at night, mm-hmm. but still ended up with a 3.6.
Okay. What about his?
About 3.2.
Okay. Cool. And how much debt have you guys used in order to build this wealth?
Only, we have two homes, and we paid off one home already, so just mortgages on homes, that's
some
it.
Some mortgages is all. How many new cars have you bought in your life?
That's interesting. I've bought a lot of cars in my life, but we have 5 cars now, all bought 1 to 2 years old, mm-hmm. and one of them, our current one, is we bought from the dealership manager. He mm-hmm. was using it as a demo.
Mm-hmm. But before you had the wealth, how many new cars did you buy?
Gosh, probably about 10.
Okay, so you bought new cars, brand new cars a lot.
No, never new.
I'm talking about brand new.
No, zero new.
Oh, zero. And you have 5 cars now?
Yes.
Very well, you should. You have $3 million. Good for you. That's cool. What's the most expensive pair of jeans that either one of you have ever bought?
Well, I've purchased at high-end consignment stores. That's only where I shop.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say the most expensive is 30, but they were high-end. So they were very nice, but they were still 30 at consignment stores.
So they,
no one knows that you're wearing them. So
it might have been a $200 pair of jeans then.
Yes, exactly.
But you paid 30 for them. I got you.
Right.
So mm-hmm. what is your generosity pattern, your giving pattern look like in your life?
You know, Dave, my generosity has been to our synagogue
mm-hmm.
and then the Diabetes Foundation. And quite frankly, we give to the Republican Party, you know, to ensure that the American dream is going to be there for our kids.
Ah, very
so
cool.
I do that as giving as well.
I don't disagree. Or investing, one of the two. But giving is a type of investing, so I love it. Good for you. All right. Fun. So what do you attribute your ability to start with nothing all those years ago, averaging $125,000 a year income, and now you're 57 years old with $3 million? How do you tell people how you did that?
I attribute it to my parents. They were great role models. They are great role models. They're still living. My mother has an incredible work ethic, and my father always told me to purchase items with cash only.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say a great, you know, intact family, really good parents,
mm-hmm.
but also sacrificing. I sacrificed a lot. I worked mm-hmm. while I went to school, and overall, that's what I would say, but always living below, way below your means. So.
Talk to me about the math, though, because a lot of people sacrifice and a lot of people work hard, and they don't have $3 million.
Mm-hmm.
How'd the math work on this? How did you end up with $3 million?
Well, doing 2, 3, 4, sometimes 5 jobs at a time.
Oh, okay.
My husband gets Social Security now. He also has a full-time position.
Mm-hmm.
I have a day job as an IT program manager, but mm-hmm. I also have a side business as a career advisor. Mm-hmm. So, you know,
and then you guys just threw, according to this, you said a bunch of this was in real estate. So you threw it to real estate hard, didn't you?
Like you do, yes.
Yeah. Okay. And so you made some money on your real estate, I guess.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Good. Good. So real estate is investing and saving, but a lot of hard work and a lot of just living on less than you make.
And exactly, to be able, you know, the cash flow, both kids of ours are in state university right now, so cash flowing that. Son's going to go to medical school, and we're going to cash flow that. And
when you hear one of these people in the political realm say stuff about the wealthy, the wealthy, the wealthy, the wealthy, how does that make you feel?
You know, it really is disconcerting because they don't get it. And it's a shame because if more people really understood that they can do it too versus saying you can't do it, you're just a 99%er and you're always going to be minimum wage, they kind of almost keep them down. But the true story is working hard does pay off, sacrificing does pay off, and I think the politicians need to get on on the task with the fact that there are people doing it and they need to stop lying.
Yeah. Amen. All right. Very cool. Thanks for sharing with us, Rachel. I appreciate you joining us.
Hey, Dave, thank you for all you do. We really, really love it.
Well, we appreciate you very much for being part of this. It's a big deal to do these millionaire theme hours. Jeremy and Victoria are with us in Denver, Colorado. Welcome, guys.
Thank you, Dave.
Good to have you. So what's your all's net worth?
About $1.2 million.
About $1.2 million. Very good. And what's that invested in?
Part of that is retirement investments, about $400,000 there, and then another a little over $600,000 in real estate. We own a rental property in our primary residence.
Okay, very cool, very cool. And how old are you guys?
36 and 33.
Whoa, you're young millionaires. Excellent. And what has been your income through your working life average?
Average is about 150, but started out, you know, in that 50, 60,000 and when I started my working career, and I've been in sales and every year have been able to increase and increase and really increase here the last couple of years.
So you're in sales, and yes. What does Victoria do?
I'm home with the kids.
Full-time mom, okay.
Yep.
And so, Jeremy, what's your degree in?
I have a marketing degree.
Okay. And what was your GPA?
Somewhere around 3.5.
Okay. All right. And talk about what part debt has played positively or negatively in this equation.
You know, the only debt we've ever had, we both came into our marriage debt-free with no loans, college loans. The only loan we had outside of our mortgage was a car. We bought one new car when we first got married, and that was the only time. Paid it off early, and that was that. So we've done our best to live by your principles, going through FPU early on in our marriage and then going through it again here about 3 years ago.
Wow.
And that's kind of where we got on this path to wanting to get rid of the remaining debt.
Okay. So that's when you got the house paid off, huh?
Yes. We paid the rental off. And then last year we paid off our primary, and we were lucky enough to get the call and give you our debt-free scream.
Oh, so you did an on-air debt-free scream. Very cool. So you've done both things now, the debt-free scream and the millionaire hour. That's neat.
Yes, sir.
Well, there's probably a correlation there. Love it. That's awesome. So did you inherit money?
No, neither one of us did. We're first generation.
Okay, all right. And what part did giving play in your all's building wealth?
It played a large part. You know, once we learned that early on that it's not our money anyway, kind of like you talk about, it's a lot easier to give it away, and so we try to manage it the best that we can. Some months our giving is equal to or more than what we live on. And when we started our journey, we committed to increasing our giving as a percentage of our budget each year. And so God has just continued to bless that.
Wow. So you start with a tithe and then you go up from there, huh?
Yes.
Okay. I love it. Very cool. What's the most expensive jeans you buy, Victoria?
Oh, probably $50, $60.
Very cool. That's good. Yeah. Good. How's it feel? Does it feel weird to be a millionaire?
Yeah, a little bit.
I mean, at 33 definitely. Years old, you're a millionaire.
Yeah, we've been very, very blessed.
Yeah, you have been. That's how it feels, is blessed. So talk to people that are your age group or you know, in their late 20s or whatever. What do you attribute this to? Tell them the secrets of the millionaire, because they're not secrets, right? But tell them what the principles are.
Right. I think what Jeremy said is, the sooner you realize that it's not your money anyway, just makes it so much easier to manage it well. Live within your means, you know. No matter what you make, you have to live on less than what you make, and, you know, be able to save and give. And the sooner you figure those, you know, few key principles out, the sooner it can happen.
Does it sound weird when I say out loud that if you keep on the track you're on, with no huge catastrophes or tragedies, that you're probably going to have $20 million when you're 70?
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Because that's where you're headed. You realize that. Mathematically, wow. That's what should happen.
Wow.
And that's with no huge, you know, that's without you, you know, maybe you don't make $500 a year. You just keep making about what you're making. You don't double your income or anything. And you probably will do that, actually, is my guess. But congratulations, you guys. Thanks for being a great American success story.
Thank you.
We appreciate you talking about these and giving us the chance to come on and share. We hope it's encouragement to others.
It absolutely is. No question about that. Carolyn is with us in Allentown, Pennsylvania, another one of our millionaires. What's your net worth, Carolyn?
Hi, Dave.
Hi.
Our net worth is about 1.25.
Cool. What's it invested in?
Our house is worth about $500,000. We have about $650,000 in our retirement. We have $45,000 in a college fund for our daughter. She's mm-hmm. 8. We have saved $25,000 for our next car.
How old are you guys?
We're 43 years old.
Whoa, young millionaires. Good for you. And what's your average income been through your working lifetime?
We've probably averaged about $80,000.
What do you guys do for a living? What's your career?
My husband is an electrician, mm-hmm. and my background is nursing. I work for a health education company now.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what are your degrees in?
So I have my undergraduate, I have a bachelor's of science in nursing, and then I have a master's degree in health psychology. Mm-hmm. And my husband didn't go to college.
Okay. And your GPA?
My undergrad was 2.9, and my graduate was 3.8.
Cool. And how much debt have you guys used to cause this net worth to be here?
We did buy our first house when we were first married at 22. It was $94,000, and we didn't have any money. I just about died. I mean, I threw mm-hmm. up practically. But we paid that off in 4 years. And that motivated us to just stay out of debt.
So you've not borrowed any. You didn't have any other money. You didn't have student loans.
My husband didn't go to college, so I paid my way through college, mm-hmm. and so we didn't really. We had like $2,000 to pay off when we got married.
How many new cars have you bought?
Two. But okay. Our last car we paid for in cash, and it was used, and that's the way we're going mm-hmm. going forward. Mm-hmm.
And did you inherit money?
I wouldn't say we inherited money, but I worked really hard for a startup company, and when they went public, I did get, from the stock, I got $100,000, and that was about 10 years ago, and we paid off our mortgage at that time.
But that's not an inheritance, yeah. That's just
it wasn't, no.
It was part of your compensation package, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that was all good.
Right. And what part did giving play?
Yeah, when we were first, we got married at 22, we didn't have any money to give, but we gave a lot of our time. We volunteered a lot. But as mm-hmm. the years have gone on, it's been really easy to just give things away. And then, yeah, we give at least 10% of our money away now. And it's fun now because we have certain causes that are important to us, and we can give to them. So yeah. That's a good thing.
What's the most expensive jeans you buy?
I buy all my clothes from a consignment store. I would say my average pair of jeans is about $4.50.
That's ridiculous. Go get you some good jeans. That's fabulous. All right, Carolyn, you told me twice that a couple of these things, like buying the house and so forth, scared you. So fear was kind of in the picture as maybe maybe as a positive motivator. I don't know. Tell the younger Carolyn how she should do this and that she can do this, the younger version of you.
I would say try to get more sleep and stop worrying so much because mm-hmm. it will work out. Mm-hmm. And to say thank you to your husband, Mike. Mm-hmm. Gosh, he's such a hard worker. Mm-hmm.
What were the principles that caused you guys to be millionaires? If you're talking to the younger you, do this, do this, don't do this, don't do that.
I would say work very, very hard when you're young because you're going to get more tired when you get older and you don't have the energy to do the overtime. But those early years, pick up as many hours as you can and just work and work and work and hang on to your marriage. It's a roller coaster, and then eventually things will calm down and you'll have more time for everything. And you won't need to be working so hard.
Yeah, and it works out. Yeah,
It works out.
So were you steady in your investing, or has most of that been in the last few years?
We're steady. But we definitely have been able to invest more since we make more. We don't pay anybody any, you know.
Has it occurred to you that you're only 43, and so by the time you're 63, you're probably going to be worth $10 million?
I've looked at those calculators with disbelief. I don't know. I'm scared about that. We'll be fine. I know we'll be fine. Yeah. It's a comfort. I can sleep well at night.
Yeah, you're on your way. There's no doubt. If you keep the same, without the same work ethic, I mean, crazy amounts of work, but just if you just keep the same disciplines in your financial side of your life, that's where this is headed. in 20 years if you don't do much else, if you just keep control of what you're doing. And that's where the math will take you. So very, very impressive. Thank you so much for being a great American success story. Glenn's going to start us off in Oklahoma City. Hey, Glenn, how are you?
Oh, man, better than I deserve, Dave.
Good. So what's your net worth, sir?
My wife and I are worth $5.5 million.
Very cool. And what is that primarily invested in? What are the big chunks?
Yeah, 75%, of course, is in stocks and mutual funds. Part of it in the IRA and part of it just in other money that we can get to without penalty. 20% in real estate and about 5% in cash.
Okay. And so what's like your home worth as an example?
About $500,000.
Okay, cool. And what's been your income throughout your working lifetime average or range or something?
Yeah, it's probably, about $140,000 a year for the last 30 years.
Okay, cool. And how much of this $5.5 million did you inherit?
The only money that I inherited was when my father passed about 9 years ago. He had a life insurance policy, and proceeds from that were about $250,000 to me.
Okay, but you were already a millionaire by then, weren't you?
Yeah. So it was just, just a little bit extra he gave us.
Yeah, gotcha. And how old are you now, you and your wife?
I'm 56, and my wife is 52.
Okay, very cool. And what has been your career in your working lifetime?
So I was a drilling engineer for an oil company. Started out as a roughneck, working on the rig, and then went back to university. And then we lived all over the world and came back to Oklahoma here about a year ago to be close to our children. My wife is a pharmacist, but she worked very little because she stayed home, took care of the children mostly, and then she, when we were overseas, she wasn't able to work that much.
Gotcha. Well, and what was your degree in then, engineering or chemical engineering? Or
Petroleum engineering.
Petroleum engineering, okay. All right, cool. And what was your GPA?
3.4, I believe, overall.
Okay. And how much of this wealth was caused by you borrowing money to invest?
We never borrowed any money to invest, like in the stock market. Mm-hmm. I think one time we bought a rent house. When we were in Canada, we bought a rent house. And we borrowed money to do that. Mm-hmm. Actually, Dave, I a couple years ago, I did the stupid thing. I bought my house with the cheap and got a mortgage so that I could, quote, get the better return in the market.
Mm-hmm.
And, that didn't work out so well. So so debt has paid very little, played very little part in it.
Gotcha. Okay. What about giving? What has been your giving patterns?
So, of course, we're Christian, so we've tithed. When I was making $4 an hour, I was tithing, and, now we're still tithers. We've supported the same missionaries for 30 years and, give to our family, of course, to meet their needs. And then we funded a scholarship in my father's name that's perpetual, so that it's even if we never give any more to it, it'll keep going. So,
what's the most expensive pair of jeans you ever bought?
$100.
Okay, cool. And how many brand new cars did you buy prior to having at least $1 million net worth?
Before having $1 million prior, probably I've bought 8 new cars total in my life. Prior to being a millionaire, probably 4 or 5 of those.
Okay, so you bought new cars. Okay, cool. All right, and how many nonfiction books do you read a year?
Oh, I tried to read a couple of a month, so I'd say 24. I got a list of books, that I have read and need to read still. But, so a couple of months.
Not counting Dave Ramsey books, what's the best book you've read in the last 12 months?
Oh, man, the Founding Fathers on Leadership. It's about George Washington and those guys.
Good.
And, and then, of course, Failing Forward or Intentional Living by Maxwell.
Yeah, I love Maxwell. He's going to be at our Entree Summit in the spring. So very cool. Well, Glenn, you and your wife are great American heroes. You have you've lived the dream. Do you think that if somebody starting out today was working a roughneck, they could work their way up like you have?
Oh yeah. I mean, it's it's the pay yourself first, right? You know, tithe and then put money aside and then live on the rest, live below your means and delay gratification and, yeah.
Yeah, so it can still be done. Well, it's an honor to talk to you, sir. Thank you for calling in and participating in our Millionaire Theme Hour. $5.5 million net worth, never made over 100, or averaged $140,000 income. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Jack's going to start us off. He's a real millionaire. Not a fake one, not a theology, and not an ideology, a real guy. And he's in Huntsville, Alabama. Hey, Jack, how are you?
Hello, sir. I'm well, thank you.
Good to talk to you. What's your net worth, sir?
$2.4 million.
Way to go, hero. Good job, man. What's that invested in? How'd you get that?
Well, it's invested in mutual funds and real estate. We got it just by saving, living below our means, saving like crazy. My wife had a good career. We both had good jobs, but Lisa had a good career, and she did get some stock options that were a big start. But
yeah. What was her career?
She was a distribution director.
Okay. What did you do for a living?
I'm an electronics technician.
Okay. And how old are you guys?
I'm 43 and she's 46.
Wow, you're young millionaires. Good. So how much of the $2.4 million did you guys inherit?
None.
Zero. Okay. And what's your range of income been since, like, you were 23 to 43, the last 20 years or so? Household income.
Sure. Lisa's been a stay-at-home mom for the last 10 years. Prior to that, her income was about $60,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
And my income in the last 20 years has ranged from mid-60s to the low 90s.
Okay. So you guys have made $100,000 to $150,000 a year?
Yeah.
Okay. Range. All right. Cool. And what is Lisa's degree in?
She doesn't have one.
What about you?
I've got a 2-year technical degree in electronics.
Okay. What was your GPA?
I don't remember. It's been a good while back, but I think it was around 3.0. I wasn't the smart, sharpest kid in class, but I paid attention.
Gotcha. Cool. And how much of this $2.4 million is there because you borrowed money to get rich?
No.
Zero. Okay. All right.
Zero.
And have you been using an investment professional to guide you, or have you done this on your own?
I have a guy, yes, at our credit union. I have a guy that helps us.
Okay. Gives you advice, and then you guys listen, talk about it and pray about it and decide what you're going to do, I guess.
Yeah. You know, it's more of a, he's a purveyor without a bunch of fees to help us put it in the right spot, but a lot of financial advisors are a little shy about giving advice because if it goes wrong, they don't like the accountability. So you're kind of on your own, at least that's our experience.
Yeah, they're scared to death of all the regulations, that's for sure. So what part has giving played in your financial plan for these last 25 years?
It's been an important part. In fact, that's a priority. We make some commitments that are part commitments so that it takes the decision-making at a front of some of it. You know, just put things in place so that it just happens every month. So that's been a real big part of it.
Okay. What's the most expensive pair of blue jeans you ever bought?
Well, I normally pay about $20 at Costco for a pair of jeans, but I don't have much of a outfit. So one time I did spend $90 thinking I was going to impress my wife.
Had quite the opposite effect, I suspect.
Yeah, I impressed her how stupid I was for spending $90.
I love it. Oh, before you were a millionaire, how many new cars did you buy?
Oh, boy. Before I was a millionaire, we bought a couple, probably 2 or 3.
Okay, cool. What advice do you have to the 23-year-old version of you that's listening out there?
Don't buy brand new cars. Stick to a budget. Do something. Save, invest. No matter how small it is, whatever you can squeak out, do it every month, and then just be patient.
And that's how you guys did this?
And that's how we did it.
Wow. Well, congratulations. You're absolutely impressive. Very cool. Hey, it's an honor to talk to you, sir. We appreciate you calling in. Jack from Huntsville, worth $2.4 million. Sean is with us in Huntsville. Hey, Sean, thanks for calling the Dave Ramsey Show.
Hi, Dave. How are you doing? Thanks for taking my call.
Sure, man. So I'm going to do the same thing with you. How old are you?
I'm 51.
Okay. And what's your net worth, sir?
About $1.5 million.
Okay, cool. And what's that invested in?
Mostly mutual funds and some stocks, just a couple of stocks and cash.
How'd you do that? How'd you get $1.5 million at 51?
Just slow and steady, investing strategy. We made sure that we made savings a priority every month, made sure we saved out every paycheck. Lived way below our means all the time, actually, and so we just now we're kind of getting on the budget, and so we can kind of plan the second phase of our life.
Did you inherit money?
No, not at all.
So did you start out? You didn't start out with money then?
Didn't start off. No, I started off middle class to middle class parents that joined the military out of high school. Spent 26 years in the Army, and through that process, and thankfully, I have a very, very supportive wife and family that, we kind of live the lifestyle that helped us to get to where we are today.
So you did the serving in the military.
Yes, sir.
And did you graduate from college?
I did. I went through college while I was on active duty in the military.
A degree in what?
Master's degree. I'm sorry.
A degree in what?
Business administration.
What was your GPA?
About a 3.7.
Oh, it's about average. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah. Very, very few millionaires have a 4.0, by the way. The average is about 3.1. I forgot to ask that of the others, but that's very interesting. So what was your income average through your working lifetime?
I'd estimate about $70,000.
What was the high?
Through that period. The high is about 220.
How many new cars have you bought?
I bought one in 1994, and I turned around and sold it 2 months later because I hated having the car payment.
So you're anti-debt?
Anti-debt.
Do you have any debt at all today?
Just our mortgage.
Okay, a little bit on your mortgage. All right. Mm-hmm. And well, tell me about your generosity.
Well, that's an area that my wife and I, now that we've reached this milestone, we're kind of focusing on that. You know, as you say, and baby step seven, live and give like no one else. And so that's an area now that we're getting to focus on. And she's always been very generous, and I tip my hat to her. So now as a team, we're coming together to figure out how we can, better live in that philosophy.
Are you telling me in the $1.5 million that the mutual funds are there, that basically working in the military and your wife working or not working, that you guys saved money into mutual funds, into 401ks and that kind of stuff every month for most of your life, and you have $1.5 million? Are you telling me that's how it happened?
That's how it happened, Dave.
Man, thank you for the call. I'm proud of you. You're the American dream. I'm honored to talk to you, sir. And thank you for your service to this country. See, you can be in the military and be a millionaire. This is a study of millionaires. You need to be real quiet and keep your opinions to yourself and listen. You're being schooled. A millionaire drove in to be in the lobby of Ramsey Solutions to do this interview right here in our lobby. Welcome, Julie. How are you?
Oh, I am wonderful, Dave. Every day above ground is a good day.
I hear you. And you're from where?
Cincinnati, Ohio.
Wow. Okay. So 4 or 5 hour drive, I guess.
Not bad.
Yeah. Well, thank you for coming in. So what is your net worth?
$4.3 million.
Way to go. Good job. And what is that? What's the breakdown of that? What's it invested in?
Well, the 0.3 is my house.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of it is in the stock market.
Mm-hmm.
Primarily mutual funds.
Mm-hmm.
That does include both my husband and my IRA.
Mm-hmm.
And each of us have over $1 million.
Great.
In our individual IRAs. And those are Roth IRAs, by the way.
Ooh, nice.
So the taxes are paid.
Very nice. Very nice. And what's your age?
I'm 59.
Okay. And how much of the $4.3 million was inherited? You heard me just talk about that.
Ha, ha, ha. I am from a poor family.
Zero.
Zero.
Okay. All you inherited was the desire to not be broke.
That's right. You better believe it.
I hear you. So what was the range of your household income through your working life?
Well, I have to break this down to the first million and then thereafter.
Okay.
I was a millionaire by the time I was 37.
Okay.
And every time I say I really mean to include my husband, Mark. He
okay.
couldn't be here today.
Okay.
But it should be we. But since I'm the person talking, I'm saying I.
That's okay. We. Yeah.
But when we had our first million, we were millionaires by the time we were 37.
How'd you do that?
Frankly, Dave, unfortunately, this was before the baby steps were out there.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had to figure it out ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
We read a lot,
mm-hmm.
but also we came down to a very simple strategy.
Mm-hmm.
We had two incomes. Mm-hmm. We lived on one and we paid off our debt with the other. And then once we paid off the debt, then we started investing.
Sounds like our plan.
That's what we did.
Very good. So what was your income during those years?
It was between 40 to 50K.
Wow.
Yep.
And that's how you got the first million.
That's how I got the first million.
And they say the second one's easier, was it?
The second one is really easy because my husband and I both switched careers.
Uh-huh.
We went to IT.
Mm-hmm.
I was an account manager, sales, and mm-hmm. IT recruiting,
mm-hmm.
and he moved over to, actually, he's in big data now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So our incomes went up.
Mm-hmm.
It's been anywhere from 100K. Every once in a while, we'll have a great year.
Mm-hmm.
1 year, we had about 300, but wow. That's abnormal for mm-hmm. us.
And what's your degrees in?
Well, I have a degree in chemical engineering,
mm-hmm.
And then my husband has a marketing degree.
Okay. And GPAs?
Mine was around 3 and my husband's was similar.
Okay. All right. And how much of the 4.3 million is there because you borrowed money to create wealth?
None.
Okay. And what part has giving played in your financial plan through these years?
Oh, Dave, I have to tell you that this is something, and you have to bear with me because I get choked up about giving
mm-hmm.
because this is the best part of being wealthy.
Mm-hmm.
My husband and I both believe that the Lord loves all his creation.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, we decided that we were going to set up avenues to help people,
mm-hmm.
and we were going to set up avenues to help animals.
Mm-hmm.
And most of our giving for people is through the church.
Mm-hmm.
We've also been able to set up scholarship funds at mm-hmm. our respective high schools.
Wow.
Those were on our bucket list. That's what both of us wanted.
Very cool.
And for animals, my husband and I have both been volunteers at this no-kill animal shelter.
Mm-hmm.
It's a regional one. It's Paws. It's in Monroe, Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
We've been volunteers in one capacity or another for over 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
We built a new shelter. We had a mortgage. And frankly, I'm scared to death of mortgages.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have been able to issue a personal challenge in mm-hmm. the amount of $250,000
mm-hmm.
that we are meeting donations up to that amount, one-to-one,
yeah.
to pay off their mortgage.
Good for you. That's fun.
So anyway,
that's leveraging your giving there and the matching idea. That's a great idea. Very well done. So how many brand new cars before you were 37, before your first million, did you buy?
None.
Zero.
Okay. We had beaters.
Okay. Very cool. And what's your all's reading habits look like in a month? How many books you read?
Oh, my goodness. My husband and I are both avid readers.
Mm-hmm.
I would say both of us read 6 to 8 books a month.
Wow.
Yeah.
You're voracious.
Yes, we
wow.
are. Both of us.
That's wild. I feel shamed right now. I thought I read a lot. Wow. Very cool. Very cool. And how much of the 4.3 million did you all steal? I couldn't resist it. I have this sweet lady that drove down from Cincinnati right here in the lobby. I couldn't resist. I'm sorry. So your message to the 25-year-old version of you guys, can this still be done, and what should they do?
Well, I have two messages. One is to the 25-year-old version, and I would say it's incredibly easy. I would recommend starting early. You know, the eighth wonder of the world is compound interest.
Mm-hmm.
And frankly, it only took us, if you put together paying off debt and becoming a millionaire, a total of 7 years.
Yeah.
That's not too long in your yeah. overall lifespan.
Yeah.
But that would be my advice to my 25-year-old self.
Mm.
But let's say it's me talking to my 70-year-old self.
Seven?
If I were talking to myself as an older person.
Oh, 70.
As a 70-year-old.
Okay. The answer is thank you.
Well, Dave, what I would also say is it's never too late.
Oh, I see.
Have a friend who is a single mom, and she's a couple years older than me.
Mm-hmm.
And about 10 years ago, she went through a nasty divorce,
mm-hmm.
has some children. You know, in that situation, you're in the hole.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She told me just this week she's become a millionaire. 10 of last years.
Ah, yay! I love it. Well, it can be done. And the there are not structural flaws with the economy that keep the little man down. And that stuff that you hear, it's being ridiculously weird. And you all have been weird. And your spending patterns, your habit patterns are not normal. They're not what most people do. But you have an abnormal level of wealth. And there is a causation there. There is a correlation and a causation for those of you that struggle with statistical analysis in your ideologies. But it really is. This is what causes it, because we see this theme all throughout our research and all throughout these people that we talk to. Julie, way to go. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you, Dave. Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you. Thank you for making the trip all the way from Cincinnati. It's an honor to spend time talking to you.
Hey guys, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, click the subscribe button to get the latest content and check out these other great clips from the show.